Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Badlands Trail, a Ralph Compton Western by Lyle Brandt. Narrated by Chris Henry Coffey.
Prologue. Full name?
Terrell Tobias Bishop. Most folks call me Toby. The foreman had a sheet of paper on the card table in front of him, a pencil in his left hand, and wrote with a funny kind of slant. It made a scratching noise like spiders walking.
Where are you from?
All over, Toby Bishop said. If you mean born, that would be Cairo.
Cairo, Illinois?
He thought of Egypt and restrained an urge to laugh.
That's it. More recently?
I drift around. Last place where I spent any length of time was Mason County. That's in Texas.
Doing what? Odd jobs, whatever paid.
He didn't feel like mentioning the Hoodoo War. Saw nothing to be gained from it.
Not wanted anywhere, meaning the law.
No. Bishop had cleared out before it came to that, losing his last week's pay. If the court had papers on him now, he didn't know it, so he wasn't lying.
Ever been locked up?
No.
We can check on that, you understand.
Answer still no.
What brings you to the Circle K?
He had an impulse to say his horse, but played it straight with money riding on the line.
The same as everybody else, I heard in town that you were hiring for a drive.
Town, meaning Atoka?
Right.
The foreman wrote it down, then raised curious eyes to study Bishop's face. He said, "The boss likes hearing sir from drovers."
Does that mean I'm hired, sir?
Not yet, and I ain't the boss.
Okay.
And that would be Gavin Dixon. Bishop hadn't seen him, but he knew the name from talk around Atoka's main saloon, the Dry Gulch, which was anything but dry.
You ever work on a cattle ranch before?
The foreman asked, his pencil poised.
I have. Last time in Mason County on the Sutter spread. Before that, Winston's up in Barber County. That's in Kansas.
Ever on a drive?
Not yet, Bishop replied.
It ain't the same.
I figured that.
We've got about 2,000 longhorns heading for St. Louis. That's 500 miles and change northeast of here. With any luck, we ought to make it inside 7 or 8 weeks, but luck ain't something you can count on driving steers.
You're saying anything could happen.
That's the ticket, and it likely will. Weather aside, times past, we've had to deal with rustlers, hostiles, damn near anything.
Sounds fair to me.
And you can spare that kind of time?
No problem.
Only we've had so-called drovers quit a drive before and leave us one. Understand, a boss don't pay until the herd's delivered and he sells them off. Drop out anywhere along the way, you ride off empty-handed. You can't come back later asking for partial compensation. It's an all-or-nothing deal.
I get it.
Same thing if you make trouble anywhere on the drive and Mr. Dixon has to let you go. You get fired and it's on you.
Seems plain enough.
You got a horse.
That didn't come out sounding like a question, but he answered it anyway.
The snowflake Appaloosa tied outside.
There'll be replacements out of the remuda. Give your animal a rest on night patrols and such.
As long as no one else tries riding mine.
Not much for sharing, then.
I was thinking of my horse. He doesn't take to strangers. The foreman considered that, then said,
I see you wear a colt.
Bishop didn't respond to that. The peacemaker was holstered on his right hip in plain sight.
Well, are you any good with it?
I've held my own so far. He let it go at that and hoped the foreman would as well.
You have a rifle?
Winchester, the yellow boy.
Might come in handy sometime on the trail.
Bishop expected to be asked if he had ever shot a man. Was calculating how to answer, but the question didn't come. The job pays $40 a month and found. We'll feed you meat, bread, taters, beans, and bacon. Nothing fancy, but our cook's all right.
I'll take it if you're offering.
I am,
under the terms I just explained. He pulled another sheet of paper out from underneath the one on top, spun it around, and pushed it toward Bishop, pencil extended. Sign or make your mark on the fifth line. Bishop wrote out his signature, refrained from adding any kind of flourish at the end. When that was done, the foreman shook his hand, said, I'm Bill Pickering, but you can call me Mister. Duly noted. Nothing much for you to do rest of today. We start first light tomorrow, and I mean first light. Got it. Breakfast is 4:30. Get used to it. And that was it. After the bloodiness in Mason County, riding for the past month up from Texas, killing time and spending most of his remaining money in Atoka, Bishop had another job. He hoped that it would turn out better than his last. Chapter 1. Breakfast came early, as the foreman had promised, bacon, beans, and bread. It wasn't gourmet fare, but Toby Bishop had survived on worse. From time to time, he had survived on nothing much at all. The other hand seated along the outdoor trestle table, 10 in all besides Bishop, spared time to introduce themselves, most of them shaking hands. Toby was good with names and filed them in his memory, matched up with faces, guessing that he'd find out more about them on the trail. The only one who stuck out, for a start, was Graham Lott, a sometime preacher, likely self-ordained, a rangy man with thinning ginger hair, left eyebrow interrupted by a scar. He advised that those who felt inclined could call him pastor. He said grace over their tin plates piled with food and claimed that he'd be offering a Sunday service in the evenings for anyone who felt the need after 10 hours of herding beef. For Toby's part, he couldn't picture spending any downtime on his knees. It wasn't that he spurned religion altogether. He had been raised right, as the folks in Cairo used to say, meaning brought up to be a rock-ribbed Baptist. Though in Toby's case, it felt more like a superficial coat of paint that weathered down with time. Close on Bishop's right, Deke Sullivan was roughly half Hightower's age, maybe 3/4 of his weight, and wore his pistol holstered for a cross-hand draw that struck Toby as awkward. Moving on from Sullivan, he came to Leland Gorch, the oldest drover in the bunch, somewhere on the high side of 50 with a permanent black smudge at his jawline, which looked to Bishop like a gunpowder tattoo. It wasn't close enough for an attempted suicide, more like a remnant of some long-ago near-death experience. To Gorch's right, down at the end of the table, sat Curly Odom, obviously named in jest. He wore a slouch hat now, but if glimpsed without it, he was bald on top with long hair down below the arid pate that draped his collar all around. He smiled a lot, maybe too much, and had no qualms about intruding on a conversation if he spied an opening. Facing him was Paco Esperanza, sole Latino riding for the Circle K on this trip, traces of his breakfast clinging to a handlebar mustache he'd cultivated to enhance his narrow face. To his right was Isaac Thorne, their only black companion on the trail, full-faced and sporting a goatee shot through with flecks of gray. Scarred knuckles marked him as a brawler at some bygone time and maybe not that long ago. To Thorne's right, facing Bishop, Estes Courtright kept his head down, shaded by his hat's brim, fully focused on his food. He hadn't spoken yet in Bishop's presence and appeared to be a slacker when it came to making small talk. That was fine with Toby, since he hadn't joined the drive to pad his scanty list of friends. That still left two. Beside Courtright sat Abel Floyd, the Circle K's horse wrangler, who would keep and care for their remuda on the trail. That meant the blonde late-20s cowboy would be watching over 30-odd replacement horses day and night, instead of babysitting some 2,000 steers. Across from Floyd, to Boone Hightower's left, sat Whitney Melville, tallest of the lot at 6'5" or 6", tipping the scale at around 200 pounds. To that weight, add a fancy gun belt holding up a Colt Dragoon that had to measure nearly 15 inches overall, more than 4 pounds of steel, together with a bowie knife protruding from his boot. Bishop felt sorry for his horse. Bishop had finished his breakfast when a clanging racket echoed from the main ranch house. All eyes turned toward that direction to behold the foreman beating on a metal triangle suspended from a porch rafter, demanding their attention.
"Rally around," he called. "We're burning daylight."
Some of the hands were grumbling as they got up from their benches, but they clearly didn't mean much by it. Young or old, raring to go or halfway broken down, even if you'd done it all a dozen times before, there was a certain energy about the startup of a trail drive that no free spirit could ignore. At 47, coming up on 48 that autumn, Gavin Dixon knew that he could stand to lose some weight. His wife had mentioned it in passing, and he couldn't argue with her. Tried to make his peace with smaller portions at some meals and cut back on his alcohol intake. But so far, he had nothing much to show for it. That was the thing about prosperity. When he and Marianne had started building up the Circle K, named for their daughter Catherine, who died before she reached her second birthday, it had been hard work from dawn to dusk, with little in the cooking pot but prairie stew. Once they had made a decent go of it, the spread still made demands, but they had help around the place, the number of their hands increasing as the herd grew and their bank account kept pace. Dixon wasn't retired by any means, but there was marginally less to do that forced him to complete each job himself. Now he was older than his father ever lived to be, and it occurred to him that most folks, in Atoka anyway, regarded him as wealthy. Sometimes, facing his reflection in the mirror, Dixon reckoned it was mostly true. Which didn't mean that he could stay home rocking on the porch and let Bill Pickering command the trail to drive to St. Louis. Dixon wasn't that old yet, and when the time came, if he lived that long, he just might sell the spread and find a city place, maybe in Dallas or its new neighbor, Fort Worth. But not just yet. He scanned the upturned faces of the drovers ranged before him, wishing he could pick out anyone among them who was likely to go sour on the trail. He'd trusted Pickering to hire them, but that didn't mean that all of them would go the distance without problems. Every drive he'd been on, there were quarrels that had to be resolved and some that couldn't be, so that he had to part with badly needed hands. He hoped there would be less of that this time around. But Dixon never liked to bet on human nature to come shining through. You could have heard a pin drop when he started speaking to his men. "We've got a long trip waiting for us," he reminded them. 500 miles and then some till our payday in St. Louis, and I hope to get there with the herd intact. Remember that your pay depends on it. Each steer we lose along the way, and any weight lost by the ones that make it through, come out of my pocket. And that means less for each of you. I can't predict what we'll run into down the road, won't even try. It calls for every one of us to stay and do our very best, no matter what the job demands. Focus on that, we ought to be all right. Questions? No one spoke up or raised a hand, which suited Dixon fine. Okay then, he concluded. Stash your bedrolls on the chuck wagon, mount up, and get these critters on the trail. Time's money, gentlemen. Longhorns were different from other cattle Bishop had worked on other spreads in Texas, and particularly farther north. First, their horns could reach a 2-yard span, or half again that much on ancient bulls, and served as deadly weapons if the steers were riled. A drover caught in a longhorn stampede might wish they were facing hostile Indians instead. Another thing, they were descended from the New World's oldest cattle, spawned in far-off Arab lands and shipped across by Christopher Columbus, their numbers mounting with the Spanish colonists who'd followed him long before the pilgrims got around to fetching up on Plymouth Rock. Predominantly white and dark red, They were a hardy breed, resistant to the Southwest's frequent droughts and scarcity of feed, in the 60-pound range at birth, up to 5 feet at the shoulder in maturity, weighing from 1,400 to 2,500 pounds. The trick was keeping most of that weight on their bones while traveling 500 miles or more across rough country, over hills and valleys, fording rivers as required, and always stopping where the herd was free to graze all night. As Gavin Dixon had reminded them, each steer they lost along the way, from snake bite, broken legs, or rustling, meant their payoff at trail's end would be reduced. Their boss couldn't hand over money that he hadn't made. The drovers weren't guaranteed to reach St. Louis either. The Circle K provided no insurance if one of them died along the way or got stove up somehow and couldn't pull his weight. Dixon was required to pay a cowboy for the time he worked, not for being dragged along on a travois through trail dust. Dead men were worth less on a trail drive than a wagon with a busted wheel, since that could be repaired. If one of them died en route, their payout was a prairie grave, trampled into invisibility by Longhorn's hooves. The steers were penned in large corrals and well-fed in close captivity, so they'd start the drive with weight to spare, then closely examined to make sure that none of them were lame or otherwise injured. Once they were on the move, nature would take its course over the next 2 months or so. It was like gambling, in a way, except the stakes were life and death for all concerned. Riding his snowflake Appaloosa stallion, christened Compañero, partner, by the Mexican horse trader in Nogales he'd bought it from some time back, Bishop kept pace with Mr. Dixon's other drovers as they nudged, cajoled, and cursed the Longhorns from their pens and into a formation that he knew would bear consistent watching once they left the Circle K. Drovers would have to watch for any strays while traveling by daylight, and the men assigned to riding herd at night were duty-bound to keep the steers from spreading out too far, while also remaining alert for any predators, whether the ravenous four-legged kind or bandits bent on rustling cattle any way they could. In that case, Toby knew there would be gunplay, and while that was nothing new to him, he didn't relish it. The whole point of his ride across the line from Texas was to leave all that behind him if he could.
"Where'd you say you come from?"
Pastor Lott inquired.
"I never said," Bishop replied.
They were together on the herd's southwestern flank, Lott riding on a chestnut gelding brought from home, described to anyone who'd listen as a little Texas town called Bitter Root. They both had sandwiches prepared by Mel Varney, the driver's trail cook. Cold roasted beef on buttered bread and not half bad.
"That's right, I recollect now," Lott said, talking with his mouth full. "Must have mixed you up with someone else, but now you mention it."
"I didn't," Toby said.
"All right, then, I apologize for being nosy, son. Don't mean to pry."
"It's not that," Bishop answered back, although it was precisely that. Then said, "Most recently, I'm out of Mason County."
"Texas?"
"That's the one."
"That rings a bell," Lott granted. "Something I should know about..."
He chewed and swallowed, then came out with it.
"I've got it now. The so-called hoodoo war."
So-called was right. There wasn't a thing about Mason County's troubles that had to do with voodoo.
"I never understood that name,"
Lott said, as if reading his trail companion's thoughts.
"From what I hear," Toby replied, "it had to do with vigilantes wearing masks when they went out to hunt for rustlers. Steers were at the bottom of it, countless heads stolen by rustlers and sold across the Rio Grande in Mexico. No herd was safe from depredation, though at first it seemed the county's German immigrant homesteaders suffered greater losses than their Anglo neighbors. The conflict between the rustlers and vigilantes hunting them had turned into a chauvinistic thing, Germans against Americans. Toby had departed from the war zone after a few months of gun work. In any case,
A recent arson fire had razed the Mason County Courthouse, taking with it all official records of the Hoodoo War, sparing participants who'd managed to survive from the embarrassment of being charged and facing trial. "I hope you didn't get mixed up in that," said Pastor Lott. "I try to mind my own business," Bishop replied, thinking it wasn't quite a bald-faced lie.
"Watch out for them steers straying over there," Bill Pickering commanded, pointing toward a trio of longhorns who seemed about to lose their way and wander off westward.
"We're on it,"
Whitney Melville told them, riding off with Boone Hightower to retrieve the truant steers. So far, so good, thought Pickering. But it was still day one, another 4 or 5 hours until dusk, and anything could pop up to surprise them in the heart of Indian country. From what Pickering knew, the problems with that unofficial territory spanned 3/4 of a century, without considering the wars and massacres that started almost from the day England's first colonists set foot on the East Coast. The native tribes, present for umpteen thousand years before white Europeans first discovered the Americas, resisted being driven from their homes and hunting grounds as anybody would, but always wound up on the losing end. By 1803, tribes were ceding their ancestral lands and trekking at gunpoint to dwell on reserves set aside to protect them, white leaders claimed, from mistreatment from westbound settlers. When Fort Sumter set America on fire, most of Indian country's reluctant inhabitants belonged to 5 civilized tribes, the Chickasaw, Cherokee, Choctaw, Creek, or Muscogee, and Florida's Seminole. In short order, all 5 tribes signed friendship treaties with the breakaway Confederacy. Most sat out the bloodbath if permitted to, but some donned rebel gray and fought against the Union, not defending chattel slavery, but striking back at Uncle Sam, who'd forced them into exile from their homes. In June of 1865, 2 months after Appomattox and Lincoln's assassination, the last rebel commander to surrender on American soil was Brigadier General Stand Watie, commanding the Cherokee Nation, driven into exile and death. The post-war Reconstruction treaties hammered out in 1866 and 67 granted amnesty to ex-Confederate Indians and promised Washington would keep hands off their tribal organizations, while tribal leaders ceded rights of way for railroad and telegraph lines cutting swaths through Indian country for corporate profit. Most recently, in March of 1871, another Indian Appropriations Act broke Washington's 4-year-old promise of relative independence, formally dissolving all Indian nations, making individual tribe members wards of the federal government, claiming more land from various tribes and barring red men from voting, buying liquor, or in any other way offending whites. Transgression prompted U.S. troops to chastise those who broke the rules, sometimes with help from gunmen hired by white land barons. It was no surprise, therefore, that certain tribesmen fled their reservations, taking to a last-ditch warpath when and where they could, inflicting damage on their long-term persecutors before tumbling into shallow prairie graves. Bill Pickering could sympathize and see their side of things, but only to a point. When push came down to shove, he stood with other members of his race, holding the line for what some folks called civilized society. More movement on the herd's flank caught his eye. He zeroed in on it and counted 4 more straying steers.
"Floyd, Esperanza," he shouted. "Wake up there, will you? Get those dogies back in line."
After a few miles, Bishop realized that Pastor Lott couldn't rein in his gabbling. As they rode along, he talked about the landscape, its flora and fauna, his background, and what he called his ministry. From what he said, at least the parts Bishop absorbed, said ministry consisted of an endless circuit through the South and border states, sharing the good news with anyone who'd hold still long enough. When he'd exhausted those topics, Lot came around once more to Bishop, asking him, "Are you expecting any kind of trouble on this drive?"
"I haven't really thought about it," Bishop said.
Which was a lie, of course. He had been bucking trouble ever since he'd fled the worked-out family farm, and seldom failed to find it anywhere. He'd killed his first man at 18, a clear-cut case of self-defense against a drunken bully, but the local law had kicked him out of town regardless. Since then, he'd been drifting aimlessly, his overriding goals being warm weather, peace, and quiet, until Mason County's war soured all that.
"I wonder about Injuns," Lot confessed. "I suppose they're mostly on one reservation or another now, but still..."
"As long as you're aware of it," Bishop replied, "just take things as they come."
"That's sound advice, friend. Thing is, well, I've never had to harm another person, much less killing. There's no reason to suppose you ever will."
"I'm hoping not. You know, the Sixth Commandment says..."
"I've read it,"
Bishop interrupted him. "From what I understand, it's meant to say, thou shalt not murder. Going back to Cain and Abel, nothing that I know of in the Bible bars a man from self-defense, and they were always fighting wars. God ordered lots of those himself."
"You know your good book, son."
"I wouldn't claim to be an expert, but I'd say I've got the basics down." That silenced a lot, but only for a minute, give or take.
"I've prayed on this," he said, no longer able to contain himself. "I've asked the Lord to keep us all from harm and lead us not into temptation."
"You reckon he was listening?" Bishop replied, only half serious.
"He always listens," Lot replied. "He doesn't always answer, though. And when he does, it might not be the answer you were hoping for."
"Amen to that, preacher." It was the major reason why he'd given up on praying altogether. Never quite convinced that anyone could hear him, or was interested in the first place. He had learned to deal with problems as they came, not begging help from someone he could neither hear nor see. Bishop was hoping for some relief from fighting, at least until they reached St. Louis. Failing that, he would meet trouble in the only way he knew. Head on.
Chapter 2. Supper, their fourth night on the trail, was pretty much the same as every other meal served from the chuck wagon so far. A slab of meat, some beans with bread and coffee on the side. In place of beef this time, however, Mel Varney had given them smoked pork. The kid who came around collecting plates and silverware was Rudy Knapp, known to the other hands as Varney's hoodlum, or his little Mary. He was tasked with chopping firewood, peeling spuds, and washing up after their meals. Bishop surmised that he was 15, maybe 16 years of age, longing to be a cowboy, but diverted to the role of kitchen help. Still, for a boy fed up with school, it just might prove to be a start. At what? Droving wasn't a life Bishop had ever pined for, though he didn't mind hard, honest work. It beat plowing and planning, hoping Mother Nature would be kind and let a decent crop survive instead of blighting it with too much heat, too little rain, and pests that lived for ruining a hard-luck farmer's dreams. In Bishop's mind, it also beat owning a spread, trying to raise a herd for profit, nursing them through sickness, hoof and mouth, whatever, and patrolling to defend stock against predators, supplying feed and water during droughts and shelter during winter storms. On top of that, finances needed reconciliation, and you always had at least one bill collector knocking on your door. If there was one thing Toby Bishop didn't crave, it was responsibility for other lives. He'd traveled that route more than once, though never as a landowner, and the results were mostly negative. Tonight, he had first watch, along with Curly Odom and Deke Sullivan. He'd caught a break when Graham Lott drew an assignment to the second shift, sparing Bishop from uninvited monologues. Three drovers at a time kept eyes on Mr. Dixon's stock for a three-hour turn, then packed it in when their replacements came on duty. During those 3 hours, men on watch spread out and circulated, singing to the animals if they felt like it, otherwise just watching out for danger in the dark. A threat requiring action might be animal or human. Coyotes and the like would be repelled by any means required or shot if they refused to take a hint. A human prowler, on the other hand, shouldn't expect a chance to cut and run. There was no good reason for anyone to sneak around a herd once it was bedded down. Therefore, guards on night watch assumed that any trespassers were armed and nursing bad intentions. Rustling ranked first among the possibilities for devilment, but Bishop had heard tales of drifters looting chuck wagons, and once about a drover who was stalked and murdered on a cattle drive by the brothers of a girl he'd left with child. Orders were simple when it came to lurking strangers. Order them to stand fast for a meeting with the trail boss, tossing any weapons that they might be carrying. A prowler who attacked or tried to flee was forfeiting his life. Cowboys who couldn't bring themselves to pull the trigger normally weren't hired. Bishop had no qualms about shooting if it came to that, no fear that it would spoil his sleep, but as he mounted Compañero, he was hoping that his shift would pass without that need. An hour into it, he thought his luck had soured. Deke Sullivan was crooning to the herd, an off-key but passable "O Susanna," circling around to Bishop's south some 80 yards distant. Curly Odom was riding to the east of Dixon's lowing herd, marked by the glowing ember of a hand-rolled smoke. So who or what was moving in the brush ahead of Bishop and a little to his left? It struck him as a stealthy kind of movement, almost creeping, but not the sound of footsteps. Bishop, his hackles rising, tugged at Compañero's reins and steered the snowflake Appaloosa toward whatever might be rustling in the tall grass ahead. He drew his Colt. It was a frontier six-shooter, nicknamed the Peacemaker, its barrel shortened from the single-action Army model's 7 inches down to 4 3/4. Chambered for the same .44-40 cartridges his yellow boy Winchester used, the pistol saved Bishop from carrying 2 kinds of ammunition and still delivered a punch on par with the parent gun's .45 caliber. With luck, Bishop could drop a man-sized target out to 30 yards or so, but in his personal experience, most pistol fights were won or lost at 10 to 15 feet. He didn't cock the Colt yet, though his thumb was ready on its hammer, index finger tucked inside the weapon's trigger guard. He'd schooled himself to draw and fire instinctively, but riding up on trouble with his gun in hand, if there was trouble to be met, gave him an edge. Of course, nocturnal prowlers might just have the same idea. They might have him outnumbered and outgunned. He reached the spot where maybe movement had attracted his attention. Compañero sniffed the night breeze, snorted once, and then stood still. Scanning the brush, Bishop saw nothing to alarm him, nothing man or even mouse-sized moving through the dark. Regarding tracks, he'd need a lantern to survey the ground and wasn't packing one. So, maybe nothing. Bishop spent another moment watching, waiting, ears pricked to the prairie night, but all in vain. When he was satisfied that no threat lay in wait for him, he put his Colt away and clucked to Compañero, moving on. Too close for comfort, Amos Finch decided, letting pent-up breath escape his straining lungs. Rising from where he'd hidden when the drover nearly spotted him, he sheathed his skinning knife and eased back through the darkness, waddling in a crouch until he put 100 yards between him and the herd, finding his Gruya gelding tethered to a blackjack pine. Pulling his knife had been a reflex action. Finch could easily have dropped the cowboy with his Schofield .44 revolver, but that would have brought the other trail hands down on top of him. 5 shots left against at least a dozen guns. To hell with that. Finch could be reckless when his blood was up, and understood that, but he didn't mean to die before his time, whenever that might be, if he could put it off. This was the second night he'd sniffed around the northbound herd, not knowing who the boss man was or where they'd come from, caring even less. To Amos Finch, a trail drive was an opportunity for profit, making off with any animals that he could sell, no questions asked. Cattle were good, but there were too damn many of them in this herd for Finch to grab enough of them that it was worth the risk. Now horses, on the other hand. He'd counted riders on the drive and checked out their remuda when they'd stopped last night. 30-some prime mounts he'd have no trouble selling in Arkansas, the Texas Panhandle, maybe across the Rio Grande if he felt like a long ride down to Mexico. And once the sale was made, there'd come the sharing up. Aside from Finch, there were 6 others in his gang, all thieves and cutthroats. 4 of those were white, like Amos, while the other 2 were Mexicans, with wanted posters out on them back home. 6 surefire killers, counting Finch, and 1 convicted rustler who'd escaped from custody before a sheriff in New Mexico could string him up. Division of their spoils should be as usual, 1/3 for Finch, the rest of it split up 6 ways. If they pulled down $1,000, say, he'd have $334, rounding it up, each of the others pocketing $111. That was about the limit of Finch's arithmetic, but if some others didn't like it, he could always thin their numbers, knock off 1, the other shares increased to $133.20, and so on. Fewer mouths to feed meant more for Amos Finch, and that was all he had to know. Well, not quite. Before anyone got anything, he'd have to hatch a decent working plan. There was no time like the present to begin. Now, how much longer do you figure till we cross the line into Missouri, Bill? Gavin Dixon had an answer roughed out in his mind, but sitting with his foreman by the campfire, sipping strong black coffee out of metal cups, they needed something to talk about until they both turned in.
Reach the border, Pickering replied. Another 2 weeks if we don't run into any trouble. If we do...
He let it trail away and sipped his steaming brew. The coffee wouldn't keep Dixon from sleeping through the night, but he'd remain alert enough to pick up on the first hint of a problem with his stock while they were bedded down. One of the side effects of bossing any trail drive that he'd ever been a part of, going back to when he was a teenager.
I hear you, Dixon said. I want to bypass Joplin City if we can. Don't want our drovers getting liquored up and mixing with those miners, much less card sharps and fancy ladies.
That could be a hitch, all right, said Pickering.
Joplin City, occupied by lead miners and those who service them, was named for a parson who had tried to save their wayward souls some 20 years before the Civil War. Once upon a time, it had been Union City, signifying merger of the mining camps that sprouted up along Joplin Creek Valley, before dreamer Patrick Murphy filed the city plan and named it for himself. And that didn't stick. And later on, the growing settlement was christened after Reverend Harris Joplin, dead these many years and pretty much forgotten by the folks he'd left behind. The pastor wouldn't recognize Joplin today, or if he did, would likely call down fire and brimstone on the nest of smelters, rough saloons, and brothels that bore witness to his fading memory. Today, there were some 7,000 full-time residents in Joplin, a majority of them men still mining lead, still single, working shifts around the clock by lamplight, blowing off what steam remained to them when they returned above ground at ramshackle pleasure palaces, outnumbering the city's churches 10, maybe 15-1. That would attract trail-weary cowboys, naturally. Dixon had discussed it with them once already, but he would reiterate the ground rules when they'd close the gap to one day's travel. His hands were free to spend their pay however they desired, but only when it was their time to waste, not his.
He wasn't bailing any drunks or brawlers out of jail, much less advancing anyone's pay. Bill Pickering, his coffee almost gone, was still computing miles that lay ahead of them.
Once we're across the border, he observed, we've got another 4 weeks easy till we hit St. Louis. That's if nothing holds us up, of course.
Of course, Dixon agreed. And wouldn't that be nice? A veteran of many drives, both as a drover and the boss, he'd never seen one yet that ran according to a master plan without some unexpected hurdles to be cleared. He hadn't liked the clouds that afternoon, maybe a storm front building up to the northeast. They might mean rain or even lightning that could spook a herd into stampeding. Hell, he'd even seen bolts from the heavens fry a steer from time to time. And once, a grim surprise, take down a horseman on the open prairie up in Kansas, 3 days out of Dodge. So, maybe rain and maybe worse, or it could still be snow. Forget the fact that it was April. Freakish weather came around when least expected, never welcomed by dirt farmers, cattlemen, or anybody else, and there was nothing they could do but drive the herd on through it, holding to whatever schedule nature might allow. Shift change, said Pickering, checking his pocket watch to verify that drovers from the first night shift weren't skimping on their duties. Reckon I'll be turning in, boss. Dixon was about to second that when one of his hands stepped into the firelight, still trailing his mount before he dropped it off at the remuda for a rest. Dixon immediately recognized the snowflake Appaloosa and matched it to the drover's face. Toby, he said in greeting. Something on your mind?
Yes, sir, Bishop replied. It's likely nothing, but I thought you should know.
It was close there for a second, but he didn't see me, Amos Finch assured his men. Good thing for you, Essay, Yaime Ibarra said. Good thing for all of us, Reed Dyer chimed in. Easy as pie, Finch said. The bum never came close. Okay, that wasn't strictly true, but why raise apprehension for his men, who were erratic at the best of times, easily thrown off stride? The kind of thugs that he'd recruited were, by definition, hellraisers and misfits, always contrary and sometimes cowardly. The last thing Amos needed was to give them any reason to back out.
So when you plan on hitting him? Bert Fitzer asked, before he scooped more beans and rice into his maw.
There's no rush, Finch replied. Got a couple of weeks and likely more before the herd gets to Missouri. I just want to eyeball them another night or two, get their routines down, then we'll make our move.
The faces ringed around him in firelight were dissolute, world-weary from the late teens to early 40s in age. Most of them had been in jail at one time or another. Those that hadn't done time yet were either lucky or were faster on the draw than any lawmen who had tried to take them in. None would have raised an eyebrow in a gambling hall, saloon, or whorehouse, but they'd all stand out like sore thumbs in a Sunday congregation. Fitch's second in command was Shelby Gretzler, 31, an inch taller than Amos, but a few pounds lighter. Fitzer was a redhead, freckled, also in his 30s. Dyer was in his early 40s with a hair lip some sawbones had tried to fix in childhood, leaving him with a speech impediment that prompted fits of rage whenever some fool joked about it to his face. Earl Mullins might have been their oldest, but he swore the gray had started showing in his hair when he was just a sprig. The Mexicans, Ibarra and his sidekick Mariano de la Cruz, were cutthroats from Juarez and looked enough alike for rednecks to mistake them for brothers. Six thieves, drunkards, and killers, temporarily allowing Finch to lead because his reputation put them all to shame, at least until some bigger, tougher hombre came along. Between them, they had guns enough to start a small war, but Finch hadn't planned their current job to be a bloodbath. It was different from taking down some small town's bank, where it made sense to let a few rounds off at the beginning, cow the locals, maybe even kill one or two of them to make the point that they could get along without a sack or two of gold. By contrast, tapping a herd was stealthy work. Going in at night and stealing stock without a lot of racket, slipping off into the dark with animals enough to sell for profit.
We're still just going after the remuda? Mullins asked.
Finch nodded and leaned across to pour himself another cup of coffee from the tin pot on the fire.
It's like I told you, too much trouble drawing steers away without stampeding them or catching lead from the night watch.
I'd like a nice stampede, me.
Mariano said and chuckled to himself.
It ain't good business, Finch reminded him. They keep their mounts tied up together so they don't stray in the dark. We slip in, cut the line, and lead them off. Be quiet doing it, and there's a chance to pull it off without them noticing it.
And if they do, said Gretzler, all but three or four of them will be on foot.
Still shooting at us, though,
Dyer reminded them.
That's where the quiet part comes in, Finch said.
But if we're under fire, we shoot back, right? Asked Mullins.
Same as always, Finch assured him.
Shoot to kill? Asked Fitzer.
Nodding, Finch responded. Is there any other way?
I'm hearing that you didn't really see this whatever it was, the foreman Pickering remarked.
That's true enough, Bishop allowed. It started with a feeling, then there was a shadow, something moving, but I never got a look at it.
Coyotes?
Gavin Dixon asked him.
Could have been, boss, but I haven't heard them calling any night so far.
We've got a waning crescent moon tonight, said Pickering. On top of that, coyotes put a lid on all that yipping when they hunt.
Makes sense. Bishop acknowledged. But the shadow, what there was of it, seemed bigger somehow.
Just this shadow, though, Dixon replied.
When you rode up on it, you saw nothing?
Maybe I wasn't quick enough.
You felt no need to shoot, though?
No, I didn't want to spook the herd or ruin anybody else's sleep until I had a clear target.
And as it is...
The boss had made his skepticism plain enough without elaborating further.
Right. I said it might be nothing, boss.
You did. And since you tipped off the new shift, which was the right thing, you can pack it in and put your mind at ease.
Yes, sir. Good night to both of you.
And you, said Dixon.
Pickering sat staring at the fire and kept his mouth shut. Likely pondering another cup of coffee, but he hesitated when his hand was halfway to the pot and drew it back. Bishop retreated to the place where he'd deposited his bedroll after he unsaddled Compañero, lightly tethered him with tall grass all around to graze on overnight. The snowflake Appaloosa knew when it was time to sleep, and Bishop left him to it, thinking of himself now that their working day was done. Or so he hoped, at least, if he had missed a lurker in the night. Forget about that now, he thought. Tents weren't carried on a cattle drive, due to their extra weight and taking up space better used for packing food. A cowboy's saddle served him as a pillow, and Toby's bedroll consisted of a rubberized ground sheet and a wool blanket. That was better than what drovers called a Tucson bed, meaning no pad beneath them and no blanket over top. Keeping his saddle close wasn't for comfort only. If any kind of problem roused him in the night, Bishop would need to mount up in a rush, no wandering around in darkness looking for his tackle. Like most other cowboys he had known, Bishop had spread his lariat around his open bedroll, hoping to keep snakes away from him. That might be simple-minded superstition, but he'd learned to do it as a youth, and he'd been spared from rattler bites so far. If something worked, why change it?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.